question, I'd like to give that to you. Next lecture, I left it to the reason why is that can you wait? I think all anesthetists are used to being kept hungry by the surgeons. They say I'll do the case in 1 hour, we have another 3 hours.
Last but not the least speaker.
Good afternoon, dear friends. We are delighted to talk it from the family. And I know we all must be a little hypoglycemic. I am a little. But I'll try to be as short and sweet as possible. I've been working in the field of pediatric anesthesia, which has been topic given to me, and for the last 20-25 years. And when this topic was given to me, I was a little surprised that Chinsa was aware that, you know, I was doing a lot of neonatal anesthesia. So it is, speaking about how deeply it knows about all of us. Well, pearl is a metaphor which is used for, a word used for something rare, fine, admirable and valuable. And I thought that whatever cases which are occasionally done, and those are what he wanted to highlight. And I start off by saying that pediatric anesthesia is all about a family affair. It's not just the baby or the kid that we manage anesthesia. Managing the parents is as important as managing the baby. In fact, sometimes maybe even more difficult because they are always very anxious about giving their baby over to us to manage. Well, some definitions have to be clarified. The newborn is in the first 24 hours. The neonate is in the first month for all practical purposes. The infant is up to 12 months. The toddler is 1 to 3 years. Small children are about 4 to 12 years. I just had an overview of pediatric anesthesia, but I thought of laying more stress on neonatal anesthesia. How many of the audience are used to managing neonates, by the way? Good. So not a very great number. I mean, hardly about 20% or 30%. So that's, yeah, but then so I'll try to take more stress on the neonatal anesthesia because according to me, I find that the most challenging from all the other types of anesthesia that I've been managing. And well, coming out with some psychological aspects in managing pediatric patients. Below 6 months, usually there is no separation issues. The parents, the baby can easily go to the OT without pre-medication also. But 6 months to 4 years or even after that, it becomes very difficult to get them vitally into the OT. So pre-medication is as important. And the anxiety is very high. In fact, if you don't pre-medicate properly, you find a screaming baby being brought into the operation theater, which does happen sometimes. And these are the NPO guidelines which suggest that below 6 months, 4 hours of milk and solids is okay. Even in pediatric age group now, 2 hours of clear fluids can definitely be given. In fact, I find it quite convenient actually giving some, because it definitely reduces the hunger, irritability, reduces the hydration, reduces the risk of hypoglycemia in the post-operative period. Actually, most of the speakers have made the job quite easy, because most of the things have been covered in most of the talks. So pre-medication, yes, I always insist on having a good pre-medication for any neonate or a pediatric patient. Atropine below 6 months, glycopyrrolate about 6 months. I usually prefer giving an analgesic in the form of a suppository, let's say paracetamol or diclofenac. The pre-medication, of course, there are a lot of agents which have been used. Midazolam of ketamine combination is a good enough combination. Pediclor is used by many of us, but I think midazolam with ketamine 0.4 plus 4 milligram already pretty good in accelerating secretion. Fentanyl lollipops, yes, I think they were introduced in India, but unfortunately I have no great access to them, so I don't have any personal experience about it. Coming down to what I propose to discuss, the differences why neonates are different from others. You all know that the CNS is very soft, pliable. The cerebral cortex is poorly developed, there is incomplete myelination till the 2 years of age. And all these changes, because of that, what happens, the differences that occur is there is a rapid washing and washout of myelinational agents. And also, drugs like barbiturates, opioids, antibiotics, and bilirubin can easily cross the blood-brain barrier. Thereby, giving you a very prolonged and variable duration of action in neonates. The average, yes, is very, very different, and for all these reasons, we had a long discussion, in fact, on our group recently, where everyone had different opinions, but of course, what is recommended is the very straight get in newborns, but it's easy to get the epiglottis. And of course, we always prefer an uncuffed group in patients who are below 6 years for obvious reasons. The neonates are very susceptible to hypothermia, so It's always good to have a heating mattress so that you can cover the whole body, and as important is the head, which is to be done in the intra-and postoperative period. Respiratory depression, yes, they are very well. They are very susceptible to temperature, as I mentioned. Because of the hypothermia, the changes that can occur in a baby can be relatively severe respiratory depression, acidosis, increased cardiac output, increased duration of action of the drugs, and increased platelet function, increased risk of infection. So that's why maintaining oxygenation is very important in this. And much of it is easy for me by mentioning that a flip-flop circulation can easily occur. That is, the neonatal adult circulation can be reversed back into the neonatal type of circulation, that is the closed PDA or the FO can open up easily. At work, we all know that cardiac output is mainly heart rate dependent, so maintaining a proper heart rate is very important. Hypoxic responses, yes, we all know pulmonary vasoconstriction, systemic vasoconstriction can occur, bradycardia can manifest, and the decreased output can easily be exposed to because of the hypoxia. We all know that oxygen consumption in neonates is very high. So almost 6 ml per kg, which is almost twice that of adults. So that's why maintaining proper oxygenation in the perioperative period is very important in neonates. We all know that the newborn kidney has limited capacity to compensate for less fluid or excess fluid. The kidney is being very passive. And of course, neonatal coagulopathy is low, so that's why we always give exogenous vitamin K. But also the liver, you know, is not very well developed. The enzyme systems are present, but they are not induced at birth. So, also the decreased level of albumin gives rise to prolonged, the drugs in the free form and the duration of action of drugs can be prolonged. Also, the poor glycogen stores in the neonate can easily give rise to hypoglycemia. That's why you have to be very careful about giving fluids. That's why T10 is what is recommended in all newborns on the first day and second day. I will come to that. The GIC has a lot of incidence of reflux, especially after 4 to 5 months of age. And that's why you have to be very careful, because there is a very high incidence. There have been instances where the patients have just suddenly expired in the postoperative period. And since this is the most common cause of that. Ventilation settings in newborns, yes, it's preferable to have a higher respiratory rate. And the use of PEEP is very much recommended, say about 4 to 5 centimeters of PEEP. The drugs that are used in pediatric age groups are, I mentioned, of which ketamine is my favorite. Pentanil, yes, I have been using it only once. I mean, one of the former speakers did mention that we are not sure about pentanil, but I have been using it 1 to 2 mics very regularly. My relaxant of choice, I have been using is entricarium. And the agents I have been using is sevoflurane and acyclovir very successfully. The fluid requirement in newborns, we all know the 4-to-1 rule. Even the Hardy-Segal rule is used by a lot of people. Neonates, as I mentioned, day 1 is always 50 to 60 ml per kg per day of 10% dextrose. Day 2 can be made, it can be 100 ml per kg per day and along with half normal saline. Later on, they can be easily converted to 1/4 normal saline. Coming to some specific cases which I thought I would like to discuss. I mean, tachyocerebral fistula, the incidence is around 1 in 3000 live births. And the good thing is I have been able to manage about 200 cases to 50 cases maybe in the last 20 years. And the results have been pretty good compared to international standards. Early diagnosis, we all know, is the key to your fistula. Polyhydramnios in the NC period itself would suggest towards thinking of a tube fistula in the pre-op after the delivery. Immediate, we all know, binding of the nasogastric tube, the 3 C's, breathing related turnaround distribution, they all suggest towards target tube fistula. Now, the clinical presentation will depend on dehydration or aspiration pneumonia. These are the types of tube fistula, and the most common type is the 3B. That there is an esophageal atresia with the fistula which is below that. And this is most common, about 86-87% of this is the type. The other types, like the simple esophageal atresia, is about 4%, and I feel I have done about 4 or 5 cases in the last 20 years. The simple esophageal atresia, I feel, is one of the best conditions that all these that can be easily managed. Tips and management, yes, hydrate adequately. The gastrostomy, the gastric distension is pretty high. Fistula repair, if only if the unit is in good health. Occasionally we have to intubate and ventilate the patient pre-op before taking the patient for surgery. And copious clinical conditions require frequent suctioning, which even I feel is very important when you are inducing the patient. You avoid positive pressure ventilation in all your fistulas. Awake intubation is probably the safest. And of course, you can give some amount of inhalational anesthetics and maybe just go ahead with the intubation. But I always keep a suction bleeding because invariably I have found a mucus plug in the cox. It's a very important pearl, I feel, that I would like to mention. Avoid placing the tube near the fistula. Because sometimes the tube does go into the fistula and you can have a lot of basic extension. So that's one thing you have to be very careful. In fact, there is a tendency for people who do laparoscopy, they suggest that you probably keep the patient on spontaneous. I mean, I have no experience at laparoscopy. Till the fistula is ligated, I mean, they say that they become maybe on spontaneous, but I find it pretty difficult. I mean, I don't know what's being done. Fixation of the tube is very important because even in my so many cases, I've had one or two cases where the tube has accidentally slipped out. I feel that's one very important call that all of us should be careful about. And after the fistula is ligated, we are asked to pass a catheter through the nose so that it can be passed across the anastomosis and the surgeon finds it easier to suture the anastomosis. Fluoroscopy or bronchoscopy is required many times, especially to identify H fistula. In fact, the Metro Transit, day before yesterday, I happened to do a scopy for H fistula, but then fortunately it did turn out to be one. Post-op ventilation, I feel, is very important, and in the initial cases, we were not doing this, but in the last about 100-150 cases, they have been ventilating all patients post-op for at least 24 to 48 hours. And the results have been very good. I mean, our survival incidence has really gone up up to about 80%, which I feel is very good by the international standards. Of course, by ventilation, they prefer is that one lung is always retracted during the surgery. Also, when the patient is, the surgeon is operating, because of the continuous compression of the lung, many times, you find that the saturation keeps falling down. So, and then you have to inform the surgeon that please let go of the retractor so I can continue for some time. I mean, we do wait with the saturation go down to around 90 at times. But that's no other way. You stop the surgery, again ventilate the patient and again continue with the surgery. Of course, in the post-op period, you avoid the neck extension, limit the suctions and instrumentation of the surgeons because it can disturb the surgical repair. This is what I have just already mentioned. The second case I thought was gastrocesis. The incidence is around 1 in 15,000. I have also seen around maybe 20-30 cases in the last 20 years. It's basically evisceration of blood through the defect in the anterior abdominal wall. Usually it's slanted to the umbilicus and basically born on the right side. Always we look for congenital associated anomalies. Timely closure to me is the best because of reduced sepsis, sacred DICs cannot be there, and prolonged hilias can be prevented. But you have to be careful of hypertension, bowel ischemia, aneurysm, or respiratory failure can complicate the whole thing. Stage closure has been mentioned, I have not seen it being done in my center, but something like a silent chimney has been kept over the exposed bowels. And the baby has been operated about 8 to 10 days. Anesthesia concerns, yes, the prematurity, sepsis, and everyone's concerned on that. Some of the tips at management, yes, reduce the heat loss. Do cover all the exposed viscera with a plastic wrap or a damp gauze, as also the lower arm of the body. Acid decompression definitely helps in getting a better closure. The fluid requirement is very high in these cases. They have even gone up to 8 to 16 ml per kg per day. And isotonic saline and even 5% albumin should definitely be a part of the replacement fluid. Congenital diaphragmatic hernia. It is a herniation of the abdominal contents into the thoracic cavity. The congenital defect in the diaphragm. And then usually present with respiratory depression analysis. This presentation may not be diagnosed at birth, but if it's diagnosed at birth, usually the prognosis is really poor. I've even had done this managed diaphragmatic hernia in about 1 and 2 year old babies. Of course, look for congenital anomaly is always more often associated with pulmonary hypertension. Again, Amarja has played a job pretty easy by discussing all this. I will not spend time on that. The principles of management are initial optimization is very important. The diaphragmatic hernia can be operative even after 2 weeks, but the objective of optimization is very, very important. So, reverse the pulmonary hypertension as if possible. improve your ventilation and oxygenation, correct acidosis, correct systemic hypertension, and pass a nasogastric tube. Oxygenation, the baby has to be kept contagious, avoid a bag-in mask ventilation, correct the metabolic acidosis, pulmonary hypertension, I feel I won't spend time, she discussed it already. And patients who fail medical management, if they are very, very hypoplastic, I mean, ECMO has been recommended. Unfortunately, Nasik does not have ECMO. But I believe there is one center in Bombay, and I just need to know yesterday that Ahmedabad, there is one center where people can take ECMO on higher. That was a new concept for me. Principles of anesthesia, again, highly fluids to peripheral venous access and upper limb. Cannulated radial artery, because IVG is required very often. A central venous access, anotropes if required, hypothermia management, and the rest. Okay. Advantages of ECMO, fine. Coming to CHPS, another condition which usually presents a little late, the baby that comes to you usually is about a month old, many a times, 2 weeks or 4 weeks. And he's feeling hungry. Usually present second to 8 week of life, the baby presents projectile vomiting, weight loss, persistent hunger. There is usually a multiple olive-shaped mass in the right epigastrium. And the main preparation is very important, that is dehydration, electrolyte imbalance is very high. And one important point that I would like to mention here is that nasogastric aspiration on table is absolutely a must in CHPS surgeries. And the rest of the management is quite simple. Meningomyelocele, yes, we do get the number of cases definitely reduced in the last few years because of AMC abortions being done a lot these days. And of course, the most important thing I feel is intubation and positioning is a challenge in this type of surgery. And always use a reinforced anatomical tube because the baby is head prone. The extremities have to be relaxed and guided. Eyes have to be well protected with unmet and thick pads. See that the abdomen is free for easy ventilation. And intubation, definitely you have to keep an assistant ready. Usually the surgeon waits for me to intubate. In huge meningomyelosis, I mean literally the baby is lateral but the head is kept straight to have an easy intubation. Some generalized pearls, I feel I covered my neonatal talks. Some generalized points I thought I should like to mention about routine pediatric cases. And there is a concept of ethnic ventilation which we use a lot during laser excision of viral papillomatosis. Anyone doing laser in the audience? Laser anesthesia? ENT? So, for the rest of you people I would like to mention it's a situation where the surgeon is operating on the vocal cords and you are exposing the cords to the surgeon without any electrical tube. And this surgery is operating. I mean, it's quite scary in the first two cases. You have to be really used to it. Invariably, you have to find the saturation going down and then the surgeon either intubates for you or you go ahead and take over. So, this is a different concept in pediatric papillomatosis which is there. In pyeloplasties, we are finding that I have seen over the years is that we do get an incidence of hyponatremia in the post-op period. So, invariably now, we have two patients who converts in the post-op period in the first 12 hours. So I always give some normal saline in all pyroclastic patients. A lot of talk on IGL in the morning with someone. I use a lot of IGL for all patients who have been kept on spontaneously breathing, especially in neonates. This congenital cataracts, cystoscopies, Pierre Robinson. I mean, I've done at least 4 or 5 cases of Pierre Robinson just using an IGL. Rather than I prefer the IGL over the LMAs because I've had at least 2 newborns where I tried LMAs, but I had a problem of post-op laryngeal edema. So my choice now has become to use IGL for all newborns, for when the patients to become spontaneous. And occasionally, you will get ventilated. Bronchoscopy, yes, we had a long discussion, I won't spend time on that. Hypospadias, color blockage is great. And yes, I do a lot of local infiltration. All my hernias, hydrocele, whatever surgeries I do, newborns or pediatric, I invariably infiltrate myself or ask the surgeon to do so for every case. That has really helped a lot. And have a same baby. It's great to have people like Dr. Devan around. I wish he was in Nasik. So could have used all these techniques that I have been using. But yes, I feel paravertebral blocks seems pretty open. I feel I'll definitely think of using that in the next few cases. I feel I'll conclude by now. This is the pediatric session that I work with. Thanks a lot for the
thank you very much, Dr. Pandit. I think I did give you a difficult topic and I think you've done justice to that. And we were really rushed. And how many people are happy? Then you might take a few questions. Or if anybody has got any questions,
why is it
an assertion? Yeah.
How do you prevent urinary retention when you give caudal and for these
I have not been giving caudal. The man is sitting there, Dr. Deva.
I mean, you said that.
Yeah. All that. I use caudal for hypospadias. And all hypospadias patients are always in the catheterized. Okay. They always have a
catheterized.
So they're not registered? No. They're always catheterized. All hypospadias patients are catheterized.
Can I ask some questions?
Yeah, sure.
A lot of questions, just a comment. You mentioned about the lung retraction and the difficulty in ventilation in the intraoperative urinary tube fistulas. We had modified our technique long back, 10 years back. We started taking the lung out of the thoracic cavity and ventilating, keep on ventilating.
Yeah.
That creates a space for the surgeon to operate one, and then that decreases the risk of hypoxia in the intraoperative period. So you don't have to cut off the nitric oxide also.
Yeah, what I do in my practice is, I do have access many workstation. So I manually ventilate my amount of rate of ventilation is around 40 to 50 at low tidal volumes. Something like HFV, manual HFV is what I would label it. So I find that very effective and you know twice during the whole procedure, I have to ask the surgeon to reduce the retraction.
Thank you very much, guys. See you in Chennai 2018. Thank you to all the candidates.